I'm Nick Pettit.
I'm Jason Seifer.
And you're watching the Treehouse Show, your weekly dose of internets where we talk about all things web design, web development, and more.
In this episode, we'll be going over a typing tutor for programmers. We'll be going over different design tricks that you can use in your applications, as well as our first ever app review. Ooh.
Let's get into it.
As a developer, one thing that you're going to be doing a lot, in fact, most of the time, is typing. Now, normal typing tutors aren't going to get all of the extra special characters that you need to type while coding, such as brackets, colons, ampersands, all the wonderful characters you have to type all the time. Now, recently, a website called typing.io came out, which features different exercises to go through and practice your typing skills. You can check that out over at typing.io. Really great practice runs in here, and just get your typing skills, pardon the pun, up to speed.
I see what you did there, Jason. That's very clever, actually. Yeah.
I thought it was good.
Recently, there was a really cool article on TechCrunch about 5 design tricks that Facebook uses to affect your privacy decisions. It's really well worth a read, but I just want to go over just the first couple of things that Facebook changed recently. First, they have this single button trick, as TechCrunch calls it, where they used to have an allow and don't allow button when an app was requesting permission for your information. Now they've simplified that to a single button that just says play game. Now I think that's actually pretty smart from a user's perspective, because basically you're just saying, you know, either you're going to hit the button or you're not going to, right? So it narrows the choices for the user, and I think the don't allow button is kind of strange, actually, when I see this newer button here. But, you know, it also doesn't give the users a chance to necessarily deny that information from the app.
Right, not with a explicit button click. They can hit the back button or go to a different website, but I miss the don't allow button. I almost instinctively click it all the time because I don't want anybody having all of my information that I already put on the internet even more public.
It sometimes feels good to hit that don't allow button.
Yeah. Right.
Another trick that they're using is what TechCrunch calls the tiny gray font trick. Basically, they used to have some bold fonts next to their allow and don't allow buttons, and now they've reduced that to just tiny gray text. So basically, they've taken the fine print and made it actually look like
even more fine.
Fine print. Which, again, from a design perspective, I feel like it makes sense. It's not stuff that people are always going to necessarily read. I feel like it's almost like an end-user license agreement, just in a very TLDR form.
Which means too long didn't read, for those of you listening that don't know what that
abbreviation. That's the longer form of too long didn't read, or TLDR. Yes.
I find it really interesting how different designs can affect your decisions and what you're going to do on a website.
Yeah, definitely. But well worth the read.
Next up, if you're looking to learn the Python language, head on over to pythonbooks.revolunet.com. There is a huge collection of different books to learn Python and Django and even making games with Python. And these are all completely free to read. Select any one, just click it, and boom, good to go. Read up on your Python. Python is actually a really cool language when you get into it. Very similar to Ruby, except in syntax.
Cool stuff. Next up is BigScreen. BigScreen is basically a little piece of JavaScript that you can include on your website to access the JavaScript full screen API. So if you have a nice picture on your website and you want people to go ahead and click it and enhance, and they can see the full screen image, you can go ahead and do that. So pretty nifty. And I, just from a design perspective, love that they're including why should I use it right there on the web page? Because that's exactly the question that I had. Why would you want to just drop this into a web page? It makes sense in general. But basically what BigScreen does that's really nice is it smooths out browser inconsistencies and a lot of bugs that prevent, you know, people from using that JavaScript full screen API very smoothly.
Yeah, I understand there's a lot of really minute details you have to consider when you're going full screen.
And I don't like considering minute details when I'm trying to create a masterpiece of a website.
You're thinking about the big picture.
That's right.
I'm
thinking about the big screen. I got it. But it also makes it really easy to make images full screen from an iframe, which I actually didn't know this. Apparently, on the big screen site, they're saying that that's actually particularly difficult. So it's nice that they smooth that out as well. And it also works with video, which is really cool. It weighs in at just under 1 kilobyte when it's gzipped and minified, which basically means that it's not going to have much of an impact at all on your page load times.
That's awesome.
That's pretty much it for big screen. Next up is our very first app review.
The app we're going to be taking a look at today is called Skitch. Skitch is just a quick little app for drawing attention to what you're working on. This is really useful in a client setting where you're doing some work for a client, making some changes to a site. You can use Skitch to capture any area of your screen and then add text or arrows or even some different shapes on there. You can get this over at skitch.com. It was recently purchased by Evernote, so you'll see that there's different Evernote sharing options in the app. And if I take Chrome out of full screen here, I can go ahead and bring up Skitch. Now, I've got a shortcut key to do it. Here's what the app looks like. This has a screenshot that I took earlier in the day of our live show Trello board. And if I wanted to call out a certain area of the screen, I can click the arrow button and then draw something to it. And then, you know, if I want to label it, say, this is a part of the screen. Isn't that cool? The nice thing about it, though, you get this little drag me icon, and you can drag that anywhere you want to. This could go into an email, it could go into cloud app, or pretty much whatever you want to do. Skitch is a great app. Use it all the time, just for capturing parts of screens or, you know, whatever. Anything on the screen, it does full windows. You can do partial windows. So check that out, skitch.com. I find it really, really useful and pretty much integrated into my muscle memory for day-to-day life. Command-Shift-5.
Once you start using it, it does become a little bit essential.
Yeah, it's pretty strange how it sneaks up on you like that.
Pretty cool. Next up is jsPlumb, which is basically this really cool tool that allows you to create these crazy looking charts where you can drag these elements around and maintain connections between them. There's a couple of different types of charts. I'll go ahead and just select a different one here where you can go ahead and drag connections around. And it says, do I want to connect window 1 to window 2? Yeah, absolutely. Let's go ahead and look at another one that maybe includes some animation. So you can click on stuff and it will smoothly animate around. You can actually use this with a couple of different libraries. You can use it with MooTools, or you can use it with YUI3. But of course, I think most people are going to be using it with jQuery just because it's the most popular JavaScript library out there.
Yeah, something like 80% of websites use jQuery now.
Yeah. The thing that I was impressed by is you can also use it with different rendering modes. So you can not only render this with SVG, you can also do this with the canvas or even VML, which I thought was pretty nifty.
Wow, that's interesting.
Yeah.
You don't hear much about VML anymore.
No, you don't. That's why like I saw that and I thought, geez, that's crazy.
It's way backward compatibility.
Mm-hmm. Way back. But it's pretty cool stuff. You can go ahead and download jsPlumb on GitHub and put it in your website. So the next time your boss asks you to go ahead and put together a drag and drop interface,
this never happens.
You can go ahead and make it really easy on yourself.
Visually, it reminds me a little bit of Yahoo Pipes. Not in functionality, but in what it lets you do.
Just in the front end of Yahoo Pipes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Pretty cool stuff.
So next up, there is a blog post on some web development tips. This is some really, really useful information from a former engineer at Dig. And as you go through, this is maybe not so much for a beginner to take a look at. I mean, read the lists, keep some things in mind. But when you get to a more intermediate level of doing web development, fantastic tips in here. Just going to call out a couple things. I don't have time to go over the whole article in this show. But things to keep in mind, unless you're using a framework, you are most likely not protecting yourself against things like cross-site request forgery attacks, especially AJAX requests. So you have to learn about how to use Ajax setup so that you include your different tokens by default. Performance side, something we talk about on the show a lot is spriting your assets. On previous episodes, we've gone over a few tools that you can use to make CSS spriting a lot easier. And just generally really, really great advice on dealing with kind of larger scale web applications and websites and what goes into actually developing them. So keep that in mind, check it out. The link will be in the show notes over on our page.
Pretty cool stuff. Next up, I'd like to finish out by talking about, well, actually, you have one more segment after me. I'm sorry. I almost ended the show early there. That could have been a disaster. Next up, we're going to talk about complex navigation patterns for responsive web design. Now, this is something that I have actually given talks about in the past, because I think that as we move towards this new responsive web design era, we have to develop basically design patterns that are going to fit across mobile devices, you know, including tablets and phones, as well as desktops, because we've established a lot of design patterns that will work for desktops, but we need to kind of modify those so that they work across a whole array of devices. And I really like this blog post from Brad Frost, where he talks about basically just that. He shows how navigation can be modified as a design pattern across various devices. The one I'd like to highlight is down at the bottom here, where on the World Wildlife Fund's responsive website, they have, you know, these drop-down menus where you can go ahead and look at species, places, and threats, and then you can select something underneath that. When you go down to the mobile size, they actually just have that top level of navigation. So you click on that, and it takes you to the category landing page instead of actually having you drill down into the other various topics. So pretty cool stuff, well worth the read, and I like that it also breaks down the pros and cons of each, because there's not necessarily always going to be one really good solution that works for everything.
Yeah, we're still in the really early days of all this stuff, so.
For sure. I mean, responsive web design has been around since around May of 2010, I think.
But oh, wow, that's ancient in internet years.
In internet time, it does seem like a long time, but I think there's actually still a whole lot more to discover there that we haven't really fully explored in terms of design.
1 year is actually equal to 20 internet years. Just keep that in mind when you're doing the internet year math.
That's a cool factoid. Thanks for that, Jason.
Next up, we're talking about a quick little project called Avgrund. And this is just a fun experiment thought that we would display on the show. This is modal dialogues in jQuery. And the cool thing about it is that it uses CSS3 transforms to scale components of the background and blur things out when you click the modal. Nothing extremely useful about it. It's really just an experiment, but it's so cool that you can do these things now, and it's really smooth. That's it. You can check out the code over on the GitHub, and again, the link will be in the show notes. So, really like it. Avgrund.
Very cool stuff. Well, that's it for this week's episode of the Treehouse Show. Jason, what did we learn today?
We learned that there's no right way to do responsive web design.
That's right. We also learned that your boss is probably going to ask you for a drag and drop interface very soon, and you should be prepared for that. And I think that's pretty much it.
Yeah, I think that's about it.
I feel good.
I feel great. Never been better. If you want to learn more about web design or web development, check out teamtreehouse.com.
And be sure to check out previous episodes at youtube.com/gotreehouse. That's it for this week's episode. I'm Nick Pettit, and I'm at NickRP on Twitter.
And I'm Jason Seifer, and I'm at jseifer on Twitter.
We'll see you next week.